This episode of Good Chat is brought to you by Simmons Homes. Every day across Australia, it's tools up for Team Simmons because their people stand by their promise to start building your new home on time and on budget. So if you're ready to join the hundreds of Australians they're welcoming home each month, talk to Simmons, the great Australian builder. Now on with the show.
Okay, today's guest is one of the Melbourne Football Club's greatest ever stars, being one of just four players in the club's history to have led the goal kicking in four or more seasons. This man entertained the Demons faithful with his genius goal sense and high-flying grabs. Off the field, he was and is just as talented, succeeding as a brilliant musician, model, and entertainer. He finished his AFL career with 228 games and 428 goals, but still continues to kick them post-footy, being a popular figure in the media world and a fantastic family man for his loved ones. It's my great pleasure to welcome Mr. Russell Robertson to the podcast. Welcome, Robbo.
That's about the nicest welcome I've ever received. Thank you very much.
No worries, mate. What are you up to? What are you up to today in your car? You're back at work.
Yeah, look, we all did things differently through COVID. Yes. Obviously all those things that you just reeled off there were the things that kept me busy for a long time. But a mate of mine, when I, you know, working in entertainment, that died. And, you know, a lot of friends of mine who were strictly entertainment, they've found it really, really hard. And it's been quite a shame. But I was okay. You know, I decided that I might just take some time. And a mate of mine's a builder for Norwood. Yeah. And he said, mate, I'm battling. I need good help. Can't get off your ass and do something. And I was like, all right. So yeah. I started working for him, just driving trucks for him because I've got a heavy rigid license. And, you know, by all intents and purposes, it gets me off the couch. I met some really great guys. They're great to hang around with. And I take my dog everywhere I go.
There you go. What's his name?
His name's Ringo. Say hello, Ringo. He's a little border collie. He's a great dog. So he and I just load up in the truck, deliver all the deliveries, and it's not too bad.
Is he named after the drummer?
Yes, he is. My partner is a massive Beatles fan, or her father was anyway. It's from London, so we named him after the drummer. Just thought that works close to bingo. But hey, look, I don't do this much anymore. It's once a week, twice a week, just as they need it. And unfortunately, this morning I knew I was on with you guys, but they've called me. Oh, we need some help. We need to help us out, Robbo. As I always do, I just try to help out.
That's right, you do, mate, and we appreciate it greatly. Hey, in these podcasts, we open with an icebreaker, and it's thanks to Sportsmate Mobile and the Footy Live app. My one for you is, and I'll tell you this why, because when I do my research, I go back on YouTube and watch highlights and that sort of thing, and yesterday I went down that rabbit hole. I was on for hours watching your highlights, mate. Does it piss you off that you never won Mark of the Year? Because it pisses me off.
No, not one. It certainly was part of my game, but I think a lot of people misconstrue what I was trying to do with the marks, and I'm not suggesting you are, but for me, being 6 foot, you know, it was a challenge to get the ball. And look, you've got to have a few tricks. I wasn't great at crumbing the ball. I wasn't a tackler. Loose ball's okay, but for me, it was decent hands, and it was my father that identified that skill very early. And he could see me, and he could sense my frustration when I was playing with mates and with local footy as a junior. And he'd say to me, mate, why don't you just jump into the sides of them and get a little bit of leverage over the top? And that made a lot of sense to me, and we worked really hard on that. We used we spent hours, and we had a bit of property down there in the yard, in Tasmania, small town called Penguin. You know, we spent hours and hours and hours working on the craft of using my body to maneuver them out of the way and get a little bit of leverage. Mm-hmm. It was never about the height for me. It was more about the leverage. It just so happens sometimes you get some decent height. And look, when you're playing next to Nita, who's the focal point, he's the one we're kicking to. You know, opportunity was my thing. If it spilled out off Nader, I'd be there to hopefully kick a goal. But if it sat up on his head, look out, Nader.
That's right. Hey, it wasn't just your mates that you jumped into, though. This is a great story. Your dad, he got a 4x2, your bike, and a stocking, and chucked it in the backyard. And that's how you learned how to take your speckies.
Correct. So I attribute this, my dad was always very left field with his thinking in being a high school teacher and you know, working MDT, tech and woodwork and design. He always, you know, battled to get the kids' attention. Very artistic man. So he would always try to find ways to interest kids. And for me, he designed this bloody contraption. Being a bit of an engineer at heart, he got the 4x2. He put the inner tube of my bike wheel, you know, I had a 10-speed. He cut that in half, put one of Mum's stockings, tied that to the end, and inside the stocking leg was a footy.
Yeah.
And it's kind of like that, and I've told this story a lot of times, and I tell it because I think it's a great learning tool for parents of young ones who are trying their hardest to get their kids off maybe social media, to get them off their gadgets, to get them interested in something. You've got to think a little bit differently. And I thought that was the greatest thing in the world, this footy that was just up in the air, hanging up in the air, inside the stocking. And he'd say to me, run up and grab it and bring it to the ground. Let it go, and it would just flop back up into the air, bounce back up into the air, and it's there all the time. And I'd run up and I'd grab it, and I'd try to mimic marks that I saw on highlights reels. I would call, you know, Jezza, who's my hero, Kappa, Gary Ablett, you know, all that sort of stuff. And that was my days. And mates would come over, would wind it around a few times and jump up and bring the ball to the ground off the back. And we had so much fun. And, you know, you fast forward a lot of years and you make it into the AFL. And it's because of those marks I made it into the AFL. But, you know, when I find out kids are saying in the schoolyard, Robertson, you know, that not as much as a jazz, because it's a jazz, you know, it's the Cappers. But every now and then the Melbourne supporters would be going, oh, Robbo. And that made me feel really special. That made me feel really good when I heard that.
Yeah, for sure. Now, your dad was obviously hugely influential in your career and your footy, especially mum as well. Your mum was a little bit tougher on you, I think I've heard. So, and that's why you got, you know, you really related to maybe Neil Danaher a lot, because he had the same sort of, oh, just get on with it. No one wants to hear you complain, that sort of thing. Was she tougher on you?
You've done your research, mate. That's brilliant. Yes, mum was that. Mum had a tough upbringing. Harder than most, in that her parents died at a young age when she was in her very influential years. So I think her mentality, her credo in life was, you know, nothing's really that bad. I mean, that's pretty bad. And if something like that happens to you, I'll give you sympathy, but you've got a blessed life and all the opportunity in the world. Get on with it. If I fell over, get up. You know, if I complained about my three sisters giving me the absolute irrits, oh, well, you know, it was that attitude. Oh, well, you know, what are you going to do about it? You know, there's nothing you can do about it. And I kind of love that now as a father of my own brood, and I use it. And sometimes I think it's a little too hard on them. But it's the reality of life. Mum said to me one day, I think it was after a local training session for a selection process to make it all the way down to the Tassie Mariners that were beginning, and Chris Fagan, Brisbane Lions coach, was the man taking over the reins as the coach there. And I'd sort of performed really well, but I wasn't being given what I deserved in terms of, you know, opportunity. And Mum said to me in the car, and another resonation for me, it resonated so much, just like Dad with his left field training. Mum said to me, unfortunately, Russ, I think that if anything's going to happen for you, you're going to have to go and get it yourself. And it's just strange how some things, some way, the way they're put, work. For me, I was like, yeah, it's true. You know, if I'm going to get anything, no one's just going to hand it to me. Whereas probably some people would think, oh, Robert, just, you know, it was all handed him on a putter. No, it bloody wasn't. I had to work so hard. And then I've watched a few games over the years of our games. And being an opportunist in the forward line there with big David Needs Schwarter, you know, Gary early days and Jeff Farmer, I wasn't kicked to very often. And if I was, I had to position myself really well. And you know, if it came to me, I had to fight tooth and nail to get the ball. And that's mum. That's mum for me. You know, no, I'm saying Nita didn't have to work hard. Nita had the best fullback on him, the best fullbacks in the league, and he had to work really hard to get away from those guys. So we all had our thing. For me, it was, it was definitely, you know, no one's going to get it for you. Travis Johnson's just going to stuff it down your throat, mate. You're going to have to work really hard to get it. So thanks, mum.
Yeah, no, that's good. It's great to hear you talk about things that resonated with you and motivated you. I think everyone's a little bit different in that regard, what motivates them to get to the top. Another thing that motivated you, though, was some people maybe not believing in you. Now, your dad's mate, I think it was a time you walked in and you told him that you'd got a selection maybe it was a Tassie team or a state team, and he was shocked that you got selected, and you kind of thought, well, stuff you, I'm going to prove you wrong, and that kind of resonated with you.
When I finished my footy career, I started working for Melbourne in the marketing department. I still do that, but it's a work from home. They call me on account, which is a lot. But I was working full-time in the office. Part of the transition from salary full-time to a contract role was they liked to look after their employees by giving them some counselling. If, you know, just your run-of-the-mill counselling, nothing serious. Here's some transition from work to not working counselling. If you'd like to take it, you can. And I'd never done any counselling before. I'm going to walk as I go because it's really hot in this cabin of this truck, guys.
Yeah, that's right.
Get the dog out of here as well so we can have a pee if he needs one.
Perfect.
I went along to this counselling session with a lady, and we spoke over five sessions. And it really was brilliant. And I recommend it to anyone if you get a chance. Have a talk to somebody, get it all out, nut it all out. If you need, and some things that I sort of figured out for myself over that journey, and I've gone away from the question here. No, and you've got to remind me of what we actually were trying to get to. What was the question again?
Well, it's about your motivation. You wanted to prove your dad's mate wrong.
Dad's mate, yeah. So we talked through all of this, jumping out of the car through me. We talked through all of this stuff, and she came to me at the end and she said, you know, one of the seminal, pivotal moments of your childhood was that moment you spoke to me about your dad's mate, who said to me in the lounge room down there in Pangan, mum and dad's house, dad said to my dear's best mate, hey, Russ, tell, we'll say Peter, he's not saying his name's not Peter, tell Peter what you've done. I said, well, I've made this, you know, Northwest team, and I'm going down to Launceston on the weekend to play in the statewide. He's like, what? How? You? He just couldn't believe it because there were some handy footballers in the town, namely Justin Plapp, who went on to play for the Saints and the Tigers. He didn't play very much, but he was a very good player as a junior, and there were other kids in the town that were pretty good as well. I didn't know what to tell him. I'm sorry, mate. I don't know what to tell you. They selected me. They've seen something. And they ended up being right.
Yeah, buddy.
Chris Fagan and the crew, they saw something that was there. And anyway, I remember looking at Dad going, are you going to say something to him, Dad?
Yeah.
But he didn't. He looked at me. And I think, again, Dad's just thought to himself, well, Russ, you know, they can think that if they want to, but it's in the doing. So what are you going to do about it? Rather than me go, oh, come on, mate, you know, he's a good player.
Yeah.
I sort of just walked away from that. I'm like, yeah, I'll shove right up your ass, mate.
Yeah.
And I did. And it was after my career, years later, he contacted me and he apologized.
Oh, really?
He remembered it too. He apologized. He said, you know, mate, I apologize. I never thought you would do, but you really were a bloody good footballer.
Yeah.
And all I ever wanted, mate, with my football career, I didn't want all Australians, I didn't want Mark of the Years, I wanted premierships, number one. Mm-hmm. I wanted to break that drought. But number two, I wanted people to say he was a good footy player, bloody good footy player. And I think that I get that a bit. So, I'm a bit blessed like that.
Yeah, what did that mean to you when he called you? What went through your head?
It's a big moment in my life. You know, it was tough to cop at the time, and I've always thought of it. And you know, you bring it up in a counselling session. It obviously did something to me, and to have him, it's a resolution. It resolved something for me. It was like, well, if I've proven the guy that was probably the hardest to change his mind and to prove to, then, you know, job done. Tick. Dad looked at me in that moment and said, well, what are you going to do about it? And I did something about it.
Mm. Yeah. You also did something about the Demons. You helped them reach a few big games and big moments. When you got drafted to the Ds, I think you said, were the Demons the only ones interested you at the time?
Yeah, absolutely. They were. I'd actually played a couple of games in the reserves the year before I got drafted, or that year I got drafted. We were playing top-up players under 18 competition back then, and Melbourne had a lot of injuries in around that time. You remember Gary Lyon and a lot of guys, Paul Primke, some really good players for the Melbourne Footy Club were just getting knocked up. So there was a lot of guys in the reserves having to come through and play senior football undeservedly, and we were called up. I remember Jess Sinclair, who went to go and play for Fremantle and North Melbourne. He and I played two games that year, and I was just trialing under 18 guys to see if they'd be any good. I think I performed okay in those games. I kicked a goal and was one in down in Geelong. I remember Stephen Phoebe gave me an absolute bake for not handballing it to him. Felt like saying, mate, I don't handball anyway, so don't worry about it. It was a shock to me to get drafted at all. I didn't go to the draft combine.
Yeah. Well, you draft you, you kept the shorts and the socks from those games, didn't you? You thought, bloody hell, maybe I won't get drafted.
The shorts, the socks. We played a game with them for the Mariners against, I think it might have been the Ballarat Rebels on the MCG in a quarterfinal or something like that. And Adam Goods played in that game, and I kept the bloody the dirt from the boots. MCG, hallowed turf stuff. So, you know, I'm not sure I've got those shorts anymore, but I certainly had my first game jumper and quite a few after that as well.
Yeah, you played a few games after that. I'll tell you what, your first game, though, I think it was in Perth, the Wacker. Now, you found out your first game before you could tell anyone. Was it Damien Gasper who told you? He saw your name?
You know a lot, mate. This is, Gassy. The club prankster, club clown. He's great value, Perth boy. He had been wandering through the Junction Oval offices there, and the team was usually, you know, on magnets up on a board there in our meeting room. And obviously the night before they'd done team selection, and I'd been on the rookie list all year. Got drafted, of course, but Melbourne had so many injuries, they decided that they needed to draft some ready-made senior players. So they dropped two or three of us back to a rookie list. Well, I was one of those guys because I was one of the last picked up in the draft. And they recruited Shane Wodey.
Yep.
And I got a fella by the name of Lee Newton, who was a big-bodied ruckman from the Ovens and Murray League. And we got Nick Pesch, who'd played for the Adelaide Crows. They were ready to go. They were a bit older than us. I played the whole year and made my way onto the list. And my first game was against the West Coast Eagles. I played on Johnny Worsfold over in the West. Baptism of fire, I suppose. And it was an amazing, amazing moment. I think every footy player you do an interview with, if you do, I'll tell you the first game is pretty special. And I found out of training early because of Damien Gasper. He walked us and said, "You're playing." He said, "Yeah, I'm playing this week, punt road, you know, reserves." Yeah. He goes, "No, you're playing in the seniors. You're going to Perth. I saw it on the board." I'm like, "What? What?" Obviously, the heart skipped the beat.
Yeah.
And then I didn't say anything or do anything more about it. And then as we're going into our first huddle at training out on the Junction Oval, Greg Hutchison, who had taken over from obviously Neil Barham had been given the sack just before Neil came in. He would take it over as senior coach, and I performed really well in the reserves. Like, it was some of the best football I've ever played.
Yeah.
So I was deserved, but the opportunity was quite difficult given that you had to come off the rookie list and someone had to retire.
Mm.
Dean Irving retired, who was a big ruckman as well. For us, he had been injured all year, so they threw him off the list, threw me on. And Hutchie said, "Robbo, he's playing his first game," and he'd get the clap and the pat on the head or whatever. And Hutchie said, "But Robbo, you're not allowed to tell anyone. Yeah. We don't want the media to know, so go home tonight. Don't tell mum and dad." Now, can I tell you how hard that was?
Yeah, I can imagine.
To not ring my mum and dad and say, "I'm playing," you know, and it was in Perth, so they couldn't go.
Mm.
Not that there was any COVID or sandstone walls or anything like that up there. It was a bit far for the first one. They said, come over for the second one at the G.
Yeah.
Pretty big moment.
Yeah. How'd they take it? I mean, they must be super proud. I think you said, the 2000 grand final, your mum teared up before the game, but they were very emotional about you getting your first game and then even just, you know, being on TV, watching you. It must have been a great feeling for them.
Look, I'm sure they were. And look, I don't know exactly. I've not been around my mum and dad since the age of 16 when I left home to go live in Hobart to play in the States. It's a four-hour drive down from my hometown. And doing that every week and missing training, they needed to relocate me. So I left home at the age of 16 and haven't been back. I know the reaction when I got drafted from dad. I don't know the reaction for the first game. I was the one that told them, but I can't remember, mate. It's just so long ago.
And
I'm sure I rang them, and I can tell you some specifics and things that I do remember. Firstly, I'll talk about getting drafted. That was bizarre because nowadays it's a big deal. They put it on Fox Sports. We watch it. There's a lot of recruitment stories in the papers and guys come in with a lot of backstory. Us guys back then, I mean, there was nothing. It was just like, oh, who do we get in the draft, read it in the paper. In Tassie, we didn't even get it on. It was never on TV. It was on the radio, maybe, but I couldn't even find it on the wireless, you know. So I decided to just go to school.
Yeah.
So I thought I'd stay home and listen and just hope, you know. I'm sure I must have been just thinking, oh, God, it's a massive long shot. When you consider tens of thousands of boys nominate for the draft and only, 80-odd get picked up. I went to school and I'd been sitting in the common room all day, basically. I remember sort of taking a day off in the common room. And someone came in and said, "Hey, Robbo, you here? You know, like four guys have been drafted from Tassie." I was like, "Oh, wow." And he goes, "One of them's, and they're not you." I was like, "Oh, great." He said, but he went through their names and they all deserve to get drafted. We usually only got one or two drafted out of Tassie, not four.
Yeah.
So I resigned myself to the fact now that I have to move on to the next part of my life, whatever that was going to be. And that was okay, whatever. It wasn't until 8 o'clock that night, I think. Draft was done and dusted by midday. 8 o'clock that night, I'm at a party, 18th. In I don't know where Tasmania, because we've driven a fair way to get there. I was in the bush. Phone rings. And I've already had a couple of drinks. Underage drinking, I don't recommend it. I was 17, about to turn 18. And the phone rings. Yeah, sure, we all did. The phone rings and it's a teammate of mine who was a Melbourne supporter and he's just blown away. He's like, "What are you doing, Robbo?" I said, "Oh, I'm just at so-and-so's party." He goes, you don't know, do you? I said, "Don't know what." He said, "You've been drafted, mate. You've been drafted to the Demons." I said, "No, that's pretty cruel joke. You know I played for the Demons this year in the reserves." I'm just thinking in my head, he's thinking, "Oh, I played for the D's." Shit-ass joke.
Yeah.
He goes, "No, mate, I'm telling you the truth. Pick number 68. Eight blokes have been drafted from Tassie. It was just an outrageous year for Tasmania."
Yeah.
So I hung up the phone real quick, and I'm talking, kiddies, if you're watching this, I hung up the phone on the wall. You might not know what that is, but pulled off the phone and dialed my home phone number in Penguin, Tasmania. And Mum had just received a call from, I think it might have been Cameron Schwab.
Yeah.
Who was the CEO, might have been CEO at the time. And she was obviously
well emotional. And so I know the story that Dad, Mum, as soon as she found out, Dad had stayed back at school. Dad built all our furniture. He was always doing something at school to work on the house. And he was working in the workshop, and Dad got a call. Mr. Robertson, come up to the front office. So I went out the front office, and he told me, this is what he told me, that he got on the phone from Mum, and she told him what had happened, and he threw the phone across the room and jumped up in the air. And that makes me, I can't tell you as an individual, as someone that's experiencing that, that's a phenomenal feeling to know your father felt that way, because I have a young boy now, and I watch him play basketball, and he loves it, and everything he does, if it's a good move, it just makes you feel so damn special. So I can only imagine what it must have been like for them.
Yeah, you played a lot of big games during your career, Robbo. Was there one that stood out to you? I mean, you had your 7 goals, Queen's Birthday. I remember that one against the Pies. There was that 7 goals against Geelong. There were different moments throughout your career. Is there one that stands out to you, like a big performance or a moment that you remember?
Yeah, look, there's a few. And look, it all sort of pales into insignificance now, considering that we've just come off a premiership, and that was what we were always trying to do. But if you can consider that, you know, football's such a fickle thing and sport is such a fickle thing. You've got Max Gawn, who was a part of a team that was terrible for a long time, but we associate him now as being this demigod because he's the captain of the premiership team. But there were times where we were getting beaten by over 100 points and he's out there and we're spitting on them. You know, so it was a really horrid time for 10 years from probably around about 2009, 10 onwards until, you know, this epic sort of push to get good people into the club starts with Peter Jackson, who gets Paul Ruse, who gets Simon Goodwin, and, you know, we recruit so well. Our recruitment staff have just been amazing. Our development team has been amazing. Our ability to keep them on the list and pay them the right amount of money has been amazing. And then, of course, culture has improved. Now, one might argue that reading the paper over the last couple of days, but geez, it's just such a, you know, storm in a teacup, all of that sort of stuff. It's ridiculous. I actually made me sick reading all of that yesterday in the paper. Yeah. Well, we'll go into that later if you want to. You know, I think the first game was special. I think there was a game where we played after Troy Broadbridge passed away. That was special against Essendon. We won that game. There was a game up in the Northern Territory. This is a good, great game for me for a different reason. I think it might have been a pre-season game. Fun game, back and forth. All the locals were there, you know, winning, losing. With about a minute to go, the storm came in and you couldn't see the other end of the ground. I mean, it was tropical as. And I think I'd had a decent game that day. I was the captain of the team that day because Needham wasn't playing. I'm at full forward. The ball comes out of the mist. I think we're 3 points down. Makes its way all the way down the ground. Slippery as a bar of soap. Ball is kicked up into my air and I'm thinking, Jesus, how am I going to mark this? I think I might have been playing on Dale Morris. Landed perfectly on my chest. Went back, slotted the goal. Siren goes. We go into an ice truck straight after that because it was stinking, you know. We're in Darwin. And we sang the song in this ice truck and you've never heard anything like it. We're jumping around in there. The sound, we're banging on the aluminium walls. It was so loud, but it was the best feeling. Winning was just the best feeling. So, you know, any of those years where we were good, it was special. The game against Carlton to go into a preliminary final where Greeny and Brucey played so well in the last quarter. The game against Geelong, as you mentioned, was probably my best game as far as... Well, maybe not my best game, but as far as I always say this, I averaged 5 goals when Nita wasn't there. And then he came back and I was shipped out of the half forward flank again. And I was out of full forward that game and then kick 7. And I was out of full forward the game against Collingwood, kick 7. But I didn't get many opportunities, unfortunately, because I'm too small. So
those couple of games were special, only now because people talk about them all the time. But every single moment playing for the Melbourne Football Club, every single time you ran out on the ground, every single time you took a big mark in a forward line, a kick to goal that made the crowd go crazy, that's what I remember.
Did you enjoy game day, Robert? Because I speak to a lot of players who say that they don't actually enjoy it because there's so much anxiety, there's so much pressure. They enjoy being around the boys during the week, but game day is not their favourite day of the week. What was it like for you?
I agree with that, 100%. Yeah. It's stressful. You think, well, what are you worried about? You're playing on the MCG. You're lucky, you know, around given left leg to be able to do that. But, yes, that's obviously fantastic. You know, the pressure that you put on yourself, the pressure from the fans, the media, you know, the Herald Sun's going to be writing here in the next day. And if you become someone that's decent, you're in the gun. So if Nita doesn't kick a goal, they land based him the next day. So the pressure to kick a goal becomes just a little bit more. And if being able to, you know, fragment, get that out of your mind becomes the challenge. I'd drive to the MCG, and I remember clearly one day driving down Punt Road, seeing the MCG looming in the distance, the Nilex clock just going, this is what this town lives for. It's the heartbeat right there. We're all headed here. And I couldn't think of anything worse. I didn't want to play. I wanted to run. I wanted to go. And I turned to my wife and I said, I don't want to do this. And I was probably 2 or 3 years. And she's like, what do you mean you don't want to do it? I said, I just don't want to do this today. I'm tired. The pressure, the crap that I'm copying from people, the letters that you've written to me, and I know it must be so much worse now for the guys with their social media. Of course, as soon as you get to the MC, you see the boys' faces, you realise we're all in this together, and then you just get into the battle of it, and it's fun. That's awesome. Of course, but there are moments where you just go, this, I just don't want to do this right now. So strange, but that's the truth.
Yeah. Yeah, no, bloody hell, it's interesting. A lot of people don't see that. They see, oh, it's a perfect life if you play AFL. How good is this? But it's so hard. I mean, now, like you said, with social media, the abuse you cop and the pressure you're under, it's hard to enjoy it. I mean, but when you look, is the goal to kind of look back and go, bloody hell, those were good moments? Like when you're in the moment, it's hard to enjoy them, surely, because of all the pressure.
Yeah, you always hear players say when they're interviewed during their career, oh, that's an honour that I'll look back on when I retire and enjoy an individual honour. Well, it's the same for every single part of your career because of that. Yeah, exactly like what you just said. You know, the pressure of friends, family, media, your own pressure. Like, I'm so demanding of myself and such high standards for myself. I wanted to be the best that I could be and perform so well. For everybody, it's sickening. And then when you finish, now I'm retired, as I'm here with my dog, and I'm driving a truck, for Christ's sake, which no one gives a rat's ass about, you realise. And yeah, I look at the players that are playing right now, and I'm quite hard on them as well, demanding of them, because it's my team and I want them to do well. We all are. So, and I was in that boat, so I'm glad not to be in that boat anymore, to be honest with you. I feel like, you know, had we had a few things go our way during our time, during the Jeff White, Adam Uzé, David Neitz, you know, Shane Warwodens, you know, all the great names that you love of the Melbourne Football Club back then, we had a great team. Had some things go our way, we would have been that team, our premiership team.
I want to ask you about this current team in a second. But first, I'm really interested in post-footy, the transition, because – you know, like you said, during your career, you had a goal. Like, I want to win a flag. I want to do this. I want to do that. Once your career is finished, how do you change that mentality? Like, what becomes the goal? You know, what becomes the ambition? How do you motivate yourself on a daily basis?
It's a really great question, because something that I really battled with, I think that was, I went to the last Best and Fairest, and he ended off my jumper to Liam Jarrah because of, he was going to be the next premiership full forward, apparently. Well, that's what I was told in my last meeting with the club when they gave me the lemon and sauce. No disrespect to Liam Jarrah. Things didn't go well for him. You have to have things set up for you. You need support. You need help. You need family. You need friends that understand and can guide. but you also need to submit to that guidance and help. I think there's an idea that, oh, well, I played AFL and I was this elite footballer for a long time, so I don't need you and I don't need anyone, actually. You still need me. No, as soon as the jumper's taken off, nobody needs you anymore. They don't. And you've got to deal with that loss. Like, it's been a mourning. It really is. It's a different way of life, especially if you've done it for 15 years. I did it for 13. You have to mourn that loss, and then you have to work your way through with friends and family, or, you know, psychiatrists and things like that. You have to get over it, get over yourself, get over your ego, and relent and get the help. It doesn't have to be terrible. It doesn't have to be, oh, wow, you know, I'm failing. I need to go and have a massive, I need to go and see a psychiatrist and sit down and talk about how I'm spraying. No, it doesn't have to be like that at all. It's just constant conversations with friends and you transition into another life. Mm-hmm. I am fully, obviously, 13 years down from my career, I am fully immersed now in an ordinary life. I live an ordinary life. I am I'm just a citizen now, and I'm more than happy with that because I've been able to accept that what I did, just like your beautiful words about my career before we started, was enough. It was good enough and more than anything I ever expected to get. So I'm very happy with that. I'm proud of all of it. And I feel like that, you know, it was good. And I can be a little bit arrogant about it. And I say to my kids, yeah, I was good. I was a gun. You got a lot to live up to, boys.
You were, mate. You were. Is your son going to transition to footy, or you think he's going to take basketball all the way?
He'll get into footy soon. He's still 11 years of age. And, you know, of course, he can be fully loving footy, which he doesn't. He's probably had enough of footy. He just loves basketball. And I get that because I love basketball too. Soon he will see that, you know, he's too short to be a dominant basketball player. But he also is quite a handy footballer for his size. He's not big. But he reads the play, and he's got this ability to see things before they happen, which I sit back and just go, where the hell did that come from when I'm watching basketball? And with footy, at this point, being 11, too hard to tell whether it's going to be good or not, but I can see that he reads it, he's watching it, and he's positioning himself, and he runs all day. So joy of my life now, absolute joy of my life to watch them. And it's a real challenge too as a past professional sportsman. This is a challenge. Being the father of a kid who's coming through, when to take over, when to help and use this knowledge and use this understanding of how to get to the next level, to be able to go, no, that's for a 25-year-old. He needs to be 11 right now. Stop. Yeah. Stop telling him what, you know, that's so hard. So I'm really struggling with that at the moment, but it's a joy all the same.
Yeah, no, I can. Did he goes for the D's obviously as well? Did you? How did you watch the grand final with him last year? What was that moment like?
Awesome, just awesome, jumping around the room. He loves his D's, but he doesn't care too much. Like if they lose, he's like, oh well, they win. Good, yeah, cool. I'll be like, sit down and watch the game and learn the game with me. Nah, he's too busy doing other kiddie things like this. There's Lego over there. He'll do that. If there's basketball, NBA on, I sit down and watch it. He's like, oh, man, it's good. It's great. He watches it for a bit. Wow. But you know what this generation's like now, mate? It's all about the TikTok. It's all about the quick videos that they see and they're flicking through. And
That's right.
He's still a baby, mate. He's still playing with that little fun apps on his iPad. So it'll get to that. And he will be, I think he'll be a footballer at some point.
Yeah. Well, what are the emotions like for you, Robbo, when you watched that grand final? It's obviously an extremely happy moment, and it's been a lot leading up to it. I can remember you speaking about Neil Danaher and the influence he had, and he made you guys, I mean, you didn't even have a home base. You know, you were training here, there, and everywhere, and pulled up, and you still nearly got to the pinnacle, and all the build up now to the club that it is. And supporters can be proud of Melbourne. What were the emotions like for you? And is there a kind of sense like, I'm so proud of them, but I would have loved
it? Yeah.
That's spot on. It's exactly how it is. You know, we fought so hard. We put the sweat of our, put everything into winning a premiership. And a lot of the time it didn't go our way. And we can blame this, you can blame that. You can say we were the nomads of the AFL. We were training at, you know, on one given day, you're in Trinity Grammar in Berlin doing a footy session. And then you're down to the Junction Oval to do your weights in St Kilda. And then out to Sandringham to do a sprint session in the afternoon on an athletics track that they found out there that we could use cheap. So, the fact that nobody wanted to come and play for us and they wanted to go and play for other people.
Mm.
We weren't a destination club. Now, we have to take some blame for that as well, because obviously we didn't, we weren't inviting enough. I feel like we had some really great players. But you would only come to us if it meant you had an opportunity to actually play senior football. And that's not a reason to play for us. You come to a club because you think they're going to win premierships and you think what you've got is going to be able to get them there. So, not a destination club, paying 93% of the bloody salary cap. Neil Danaher is doing everything. Read his book and you'll realise how much he was actually doing and what a basket case we were, how much pressure our supporters, like our Coterians and our higher-end sort of money-making, giving supporters, what they were doing to keep us afloat. It's just bollocks, really. So I don't know, North Melbourne was probably in the same boat, but it made it terribly hard to win a premiership, and timing's everything. And these guys have come in, some questioning, how do I feel about the guys now? And I'm just so relieved that we've got a premiership. We're relevant. Our club is respected. I feel like it's all a rich tapestry, and it starts back as far back as the last premiership. You know, our story is our story. It was tough years for 20 years when Barras came back and coached us, through the naughty years where we were successful and the heartache of Jim Steins and, some final series that didn't go our way, some superstars like Flower and O'Lyon and Viney and these guys that, even before that, Dietrich and God, it's a rich tapestry of emotion that you cannot quantify and you cannot resolve in your mind. You just have to look at what's happening now, and what's happened right now is a premiership. And Max Gawn, Stephen May, Jake Lever, Armsey, all those guys, Oliver Petrarca, they're gods now to us. They will always be, because they delivered something at the end of great misery. They've given us great joy. But I talk to supporters and they say to me, Robbo, we don't care you didn't win a premiership. You were one of my favourite. I just loved watching you play. You're part of my childhood. Yeah. You're part of my teenage years and influential years. So I look at the 80s and the electric 80s and the 90s. That's part of my – I get such a great feeling watching all that sort of stuff. So I guess that's what I give to those people.
Yeah, you definitely do. And to me as well. I mean, we used to shout Robbo every time we went up for a market at high school and everything like that. So we definitely – awesome. Part of my childhood, mate. I've got to end with 10 quick questions, mate. I know you've given me a lot of time. I appreciate it. We'll rip through there, all right? Number one, your favourite food.
I love Mexican food. I love having a nice burrito I love having soft shell tacos with my son. I'm all over Mexican food.
Quality, I love it too. Your favourite musician of all time?
Brilliant. I am a big Jeff Buckley fan. I used to listen to him a lot, but as I've got older, my taste has changed. Unfortunately, there's only a small back catalogue for Jeff because he passed away too early. My favourite band, Boy and Bear. Great Australian band. So I'm a bit into pop music and easy listening sort of stuff. So, but that said, when I play music, it's all about rock and roll. Aussie classics.
I love it. Yeah. Your favourite TV show at the moment? What are you watching?
We're watching, my wife and I are watching Animal Kingdom.
Oh, yeah, that's good. Quality show.
So good. We're getting towards the end of it now. We should have got through it years ago. Like, this is the only... We started watching it at the start of the goddamn pandemic, but we've got three young boys who control everything that we watch. And as soon as they go to bed, we look at each other and like, let's go to bed.
So no binge watching for us.
That's right. Animal Kingdom is quality. I love it too. If you could perform musically at any event or show in the world, what would it be?
Do you know what? I played at the MCG and that was all I needed. It was in front of my people, my fans, our Melbourne Football Club. I love that. So it sounded so huge. I'd love to play it out live while sitting in my music bowl.
Yeah.
And just, you know, I don't have my own songs I'm not going to do that. That's not my thing. Mm-hmm. I've got my own songs, but no one's ever going to hear them. So that's my thing. So being able to play covers at Bar or Cell somewhere, to have people listen and appreciate, that's all I need. That's all I want.
Love it. If you could coach any AFL side other than Melbourne, who would you pick?
Oh, Gold Coast Suns, eh?
Gold Coast. Nice weather.
Body surfing. Oh, it'd be nice to spend the summer.
Yeah.
But my favourite team other than Melbourne, well, I mean, I was a Carlton supporter growing
up. Yeah.
More's the pick. I wish I was a Melbourne supporter. I think I would probably go for Carlton just based on that.
Yep. No, good answer. If you could live anywhere in the world, where would it be? Where would you take your family? Where would you set up?
Well, I'm in Sorrento right now. This is brilliant. Anywhere from Bayside down, I think, you know, sorry, anywhere from Frankston South, sort of Mount Eliza down, is just so good. So I don't want to live anywhere else other than Melbourne. Melbourne's the best. Melbourne is, and I'm a Tasmanian, I'm telling you, Melbourne is awesome. It's just the best place. And say what you want, I think it's got the best balance of everything. We may not be the best at everything, certainly our spot, but we have the best balance of all of those things.
Well said, I agree. Your favourite movie of all time?
There's a movie that I watch every time it's on, and it's not on very often. My favourite movie is called Antoine Fisher. Now it's...
Never seen that.
You probably wouldn't have heard. It's a true story. It's about a young black naval officer and his troubled life. And it's just brilliant. Check it out, Antoine Fisher.
I will. You've been given the opportunity to host your own TV program, any time slot you want, any topic. Any co-hosts, what do you decide to do, Robbo?
Good question. Oh, and the question before, one of the main actors in Antoine Fisher is Denzel Washington, one of the greatest actors.
Got to check that out. Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
Check it out. So I would love to do a kind of like a rock quiz.
Sort of
anything that involves music, but that sort of works in a lot of different things. So it's kind of like your... I found that musicians have a great take on things. Aussie musicians, Australian musicians, even more specifically Melbourne musicians. I think they've had to suffer for a long time through dealing with it. There's the sport culture and there's also this great music culture. So they've got a good blend of these. So having musos and footy players and sport people doing something together on a TV show for me would be just absolutely brilliant. I'd love to host that. I'd love to get these talented, crazy, crazy talented musos that we have in Melbourne that you would not know or see or get a chance to see. We've got such a big city, obviously, and they're gigging everywhere, but I've seen so many of these. I've played next to these guys, and they are phenomenal. So I'd love to do a sport/music sort of show something.
Brilliant. I'd tune in. Let's pitch it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Second last one. If you could go back in time to any sporting event in the world, what would it be?
Do you know what I'd love to say? I'd love to have been on one of the Detroit Pistons versus Chicago Bulls games.
Yeah.
Especially the one where the Detroit boys did the walk-off.
Didn't shake their hands, just went off.
I'd love to do that. I think I'd love to just be at Chicago Bulls championship. Not that I barrack for them. I'm a Dallas Maverick fan. Any Michael Jordan game would have been brilliant. And the only other one I would have gone to is my third favourite sporting hero of all time is Muhammad Ali.
Yeah.
My second favourite sports person of all time is Adam Gilchrist.
Adam Gilchrist?
Superstar. Adam Gilchrist is a friggin' legend in my eyes and could do no wrong. I think it's just, I guess he's similar to me. He was very cavalier, devil-may-care sort of winning. I love watching him play.
Yeah.
I just think he had a great attitude towards it all, and he's the best.
Yeah, no, brilliant. I was a wicketkeeper growing up as well, so I definitely idolised him as well. And there was that one, I think in 06 Ashes, when he just went bang. He just went nuts one afternoon, and it was just brilliant to watch. He was just unbelievable.
Yeah, he's best.
Last one, Robbo, your favourite song of all time?
Favourite song of all time. Oh, jeez.
It's a tough one. I know you've got a few.
It's a tough one. There's a few, so I'll give you a few, because I think it changes.
Okay.
I love the golden oldies. I love Aussie rock. I love folk kind of music as well. I think one of my favourite songs was always listen to the music, Doobie Brothers, which is hilarious. Last Goodbye by Jeff Buckley. Do you know one of my favourite songs of all time is Ross Wilson's. Ross Wilson's a super phenomenal musician. Daddy Cool, but what he's done after that, Cool World. Is one
cool
of the great
well,
songs. Cool What World.
Oh, Cool World. Oh, okay, yep.
Great song. Check it out. And then when I first found out that I was playing my first game, I had bugger all money, because we were earning bugger all money at that time.
Yeah.
I was living away from home, so I churned through a lot of it. I had to pay for a lot of things that a lot of the guys that lived here didn't have to. No living away from home allowance there. I found out I was playing my first game, so I knew I was about to earn $1,500 for a senior game, which was unheard of. Amazing money. So I went straight to Brash's or one of those bloody shops and bought an album. I bought Pearl Jam 10.
Oh, yeah.
One of the greatest albums of all time. And any one of those songs on that album, I can just crank. And then my last game. The last song I've listened to in the car on the MCG, just to fire me up, I'd listen to Live I Alone off the Throwing Copper album. 1996, I believe that album came out. Seminal album. You got me talking music now. It's an old day.
That's good. That's what I wanted. I've written them all down anyway. I knew asking your favourite song was going to be impossible. We ask a musician their favourite song, and we've got a whole lot of recommendations. Robbo, I'll let you get back in the truck, mate. I can't thank you enough for giving your time to us this afternoon. You're one of the greatest ever players for Melbourne, and this has been one of my favourite chats of all time, to be honest. You're a legend bloke. I love what you did on the field. I've loved what you've done outside of it. One day we'll catch up for a beer, mate. We'll be great.
Thank you very much for your kind words, mate. It made me feel very special. And go well, mate. We'll see at the MCG one day. We'll go down and have a watered down beer in there somewhere.
Yeah, we'll do, mate. Thanks, Eve, Robbo. You're a legend.
No worries. See you, mate. Bye.